Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise the living God, brothers and sisters. I want to ask for prayers and just give an update of what all is going on here. I ask for your prayers, brothers and sisters, because number one, the Lord has given me all of these awesome messages for Israel. And as I've mentioned in videos before, this is a sign, brothers and sisters, how close we are to the rapture and to the beginning of the tribulation. The messages that the Lord has given me are for the 70th week of Daniel, the time of Jacob's trouble, as Jacob would wrestle with the Lord again, as he did before, and was transformed into Israel. Instead of being a supplanter, as Israel has been a supplanter, the man, Jacob, stealing his brother's birthright, or conning his brother out of his birthright, then conning his father out of the blessing for the firstborn. That's why he was called Jacob, a supplanter. He came out grabbing his brother's heel when they were born. They were twins, Esau. And God chose Jacob. Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated, God said. And he predestined and chose and elected Jacob, that the promised seed of the Messiah would come through Jacob. So Jacob wrestled with an angel of the Lord when he had been in his desert experience, in his wilderness, being deceived and supplanted and tricked by his uncle Laban, just as he had done his brother Esau for 20 years. And then when the Lord told him to go back to the land of Canaan, before he crossed the final river back into the land of Canaan, he wrestled all night with the angel of the Lord. And at the end of that night, his name was changed by the angel of the Lord to Israel. He who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. So the Lord keeps leading me on that message to give to the nation of Israel. And just as they wrestled with God about idolatry in the Old Testament, they wrestle with God about accepting the Messiah today, how they wrestle with their neighbors all through history, and they wrestle with their neighbors right now. Even being accused of supplanting the descendants of Esau today out of the land of Israel. So, brothers and sisters, that time when what they're calling themselves prophetically Israel today are Jacob. That's why, you know, there's these different racist groups who say, oh, those people aren't Israel. You know, there's the racist black group, the Black Israelite Movement. Then there's the racist Armstrongism, Worldwide Church of God, who claim that the people from England and all that and Britain, they are the Israelites. But the people in Israel now are Jacob's descendants, and then they will become Israel when the Messiah returns and they accept the Messiah. Then in the eyes of God, they will become Israel. Today, in the eyes of God, the Bible tells us that they're Sodom and Egypt in the book of Revelation. So anyway, brothers and sisters, that's the deep teaching. And I'm just, and I've said this before, this is probably the third or fourth time I mentioned it in videos. For all you, my, you know, born-again Christian, you know, Gentile audience, I will be, by the grace of God, the Lord has given me these hardcore prophet messages for the nation of Israel out of the Old Testament. And so when I make those videos, hey, you know, it's very interesting and stuff for us, you know, Gentiles to hear this stuff. But the audience, the target audience, is the 144,000 witnesses, Israeli men from the 12 tribes of Israel, who will become those 144,000 witnesses after the church is gone. Right now, they're not saved. They probably don't even know who they are and that they will be the 144, you know, they will be one of those 144,000. So they need to hear, you know, the instructions of the Lord to get started. You know, then the Lord will, you know, deal with them when the tribulation begins. But seed has to be sown. They have to be goaded, as it says, like what Paul was goaded. In the King James, it says, you know, they have these things called a goad they would go the oxen, you know, when oxen are pulling the cart, they would stick them in the behind legs and in the behind, you know, with a pointed stick on the side of their behind or on their legs to goad them. And then in the King James, of course, it says, Jesus said to Paul in Acts chapter 9, it's hard for you to kick against the pricks. That's the King James word, but the word, the proper word, you know, that we would use would be a goad, to goad someone. Same thing, to prod someone to get moving, who is a servant like Paul was, with a goad. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'll be coming back with that. Ask you for your prayers for that, because it's a powerful thing and powerful videos that the Lord's given me to do. And by the grace of God, maybe I'll, you know, I believe that the day will come. I'll even do it from in Israel. And the Lord just spoke to me about that. 2002, 2003, brothers and sisters. I've only got a few words from people in my time. People gave me a word, and they were always about that. Going to Israel and speaking to the Israelites the gospel. So, I've heard it from different sources who are pastors, spirit-filled pastors and church elders, and who I never met before. So, I know that will come to pass, because the Lord is also bear witness in my spirit. And it's been in the back burner of my ministry since 2003, since I started working with Filipinos. So now for 12 years, I've been working with Filipinos. And now, you know, the Lord has prompted me, as I mentioned before, some of you might not have seen it, the Lord has prompted me to go back to that calling to the Israeli people. So for me, as the Lord had told me all this time, it's a big sign that we're just on the verge of the tribulation, brothers and sisters. But anyhow, I ask you to pray about that. Now I want to talk about a few other things, natural things, and ask for your prayers, brothers and sisters. As you know, those of you who are watching the videos and faithfully praying for Joshua's ministry, I ask you to, those of you who are not, please join our Facebook group. And I post pictures almost daily of some of the orphans or the feeding programs we do. Now we're feeding 1,000 children at least once a week, and then we teach them, you know, it's like what you would do at a vacation Bible school. You know, we teach them the little songs, and we teach them the, you know, Jesus loves me and all that kind of stuff, and action moves, and we have Christian books. We read the young people from the churches we work with read them books. Now, I went down and did that revival a few weeks ago, and I posted a few pictures of that in a Facebook group, I think, and in my Facebook page. The man who translated for me this time is actually a medical doctor, and he's going to be coming up, and I'm going to get to a, he was giving me, you know, a testimony about how much of a blessing Joshua's ministry has been since we started it in September 2012. He didn't know me before. That doctor is new in that area, and then I lived in that area where I did the revival, and I lived there the first year I was in the Philippines. It's in the middle of, you know, there's, now they have internet, I think, but before there's no internet. You know, I didn't have anything, no television, no internet or anything. The first year I was in the Philippines, I really went out to a remote area, and I used to go to these remote areas where they're controlled by the rebels and all this stuff. And then when I started getting ready to get married, I decided that, you know, that I, as a married man, it wouldn't be good for me to go there too much unless the Lord really commanded me to go, because, you know, I have responsibility to my wife and now our child, you know, not to put myself in harm's way unless the Lord tells me to. So I moved out of that, you know, like this unsafe area to a little bit more of a little bit as secure of area as you can be in the Philippines. And anyhow, so brothers and sisters, we're going to be doing kind of a house blessing for orphanage number 3. Now that will be this coming Saturday, and I'm going to have the orphans there from the other orphanages, and we're going to take them to a beach resort. They call it a resort. If you saw a Filipino beach resort, you wouldn't call it a resort, but they just have these tables with covers over them, and then you can rent those, and then the people go out there and get drunk and sing karaoke. But we're going to take them there in the daytime where it's not so, you know, bad, and let the orphans go to the beach and enjoy the day at the beach and have a picnic and all that kind of stuff. And the doctor, he's an eye doctor, he will be here. He's new in that area since I left there in 2008. So he didn't really know me before. He had just heard about me from all the pastors. And anyway, You know, he's going to give his testimony of what a blessing the feeding programs are, because he was there when they started, and the growth in the churches and all this, of families getting saved, whole families getting saved and baptized through our feeding program. And just as the Lord had given me the commission of Joshua's ministry, a little child will lead them, you know, and suffer little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. And so since that time, you know, every time I rethink about doing the feedings and the orphanages and all that, the Lord confirms to me that commission he gave me the day after Joshua died. You know, this is a new ministry, you know, the Lord gave me. I've been doing feeding since I first came here. The first time I came here as a pastor is 2005, and I started feedings then, and I found orphans then, and I stuck them with, you know, I put orphans that I found along the way with local pastors, and then I sent them out of my own money. I did it all out of my own money, just FYI, and sent money for these orphans and had them spread out in people, pastors' houses and different areas since 2005. And then I've been doing the feeding programs out of my own money since 2005. But, you know, I just fizzled out a lot on that in 2008, 2009, or I take that back, 2010, 9 and 10, whatever, because, you know, I wasn't seeing a lot of fruit with it. And I was thinking, well, you know, these liberal denominations, they come in giving the natural things like food and things like that. And, you know, these people don't want to receive the gospel. You know, they're just looking for a free meal. And that's true. That's true. And that's why I said, hey, you know, I cut down on the feedings. I continue to do the feedings at a much lower level. We were probably feeding like 100 kids a week. And I continued to do that, you know, all the way through until we started Joshua's ministry. But I had no faith in the being of any value other than a charity. You know, as part of my tithes and offerings, I gave that money to do the feedings. Plus, the, you know, the pastors got to eat, their families got to eat. And I was like, well, hey, you know, it's an act of charity. It's not really advancing the gospel, in my opinion, you know. But when Joshua died, you know, the Lord said, hey, we didn't say hey. The Lord said, you know, I will not always keep striving with this people. You know, so I had it right in my heart. The Lord was angry with the idolatry in the Philippines and the wickedness here. You know, Filipinos will try to tell you it's the only Christian nation in Asia. The Philippines is about 90% Catholic, but I want to tell you something. Very few Filipinos have been in any kind of confirmation classes or whatever. 99% of Filipinos don't even have any idea what they believe or why they believe it. They've got a statue of Mary in their house, or the baby Jesus they call Santo Niño, to bring them good luck. They get rosary beads and tie them around the handlebars of their motorcycle, and they think that's going to keep them from having a wreck when they're drunk and driving around. I mean, you know, they have no idea. You know, they're totally ignorant of what they're doing. Let's put it that way. They like to get drunk and stay drunk, and they just don't care. Just like the greatest sermon ever preached was by a guy named Paris Reedhead. It's rated as the number one sermon preached in the 20th century. And it's called 10 Shekels in a Shirt. You can listen to it on YouTube, sermonindex.net. And that sermon is incorporated in the video that I promoted several times called Revival Hymn. And I challenge everyone, if you haven't heard it before, to listen to the Revival Hymn. It's about 34 minutes long, and it's a series of preachers talking about revival, experiencing true, real revival. Anyway, so if you listen to the sermon of Paris Reedhead, there are 10 shekels in a shirt, and what he talks about as he was a missionary in Africa, that's the same experience I had here, and I guess all missionaries who go out in the third world countries have the same experience, that the native people love their sin. They know about Jesus, and they just don't care. They've rejected it, like lots of people in the States nowadays, you know, in the last 20 or 30 years. The gospel's been rejected in the whole world, basically. So anyhow, after the death of Joshua, the Lord gave me that commission. The Lord told me, hey, I'm not going to keep striving with these people, but I have a new ministry for you, and that is, I'm going to be just like Joshua in the Bible. The Joshua of the Bible led his people into the promised land. So shall this Joshua, your Joshua, lead the people of the Philippines into the promised land. And those of you who have been watching me, there's lots of you who have been watching me since I first started on YouTube in summer of 2011. You'll remember that. You can go back to my old videos back there from the end of August, the last week of August, and the first week of September. You can hear the original commission that the Lord gave me. And the Lord has prospered that and caused it to prosper. For the Lord says in his word that, you know, my word will go out from me and will not return unto me void, but will it accomplish what I please. So when you receive a sure word from the Lord, a sure word from the Lord, like some of the words of wisdom and words of knowledge that I gave were sure words from the Lord. Some of them are more not so specific. They're what you want to call it, an encouragement. Sometimes they're a little bit of a warning, whatever. And then sometimes they're a sure word. About 25 to 50% of the words I gave are sure words. Like, you know, God's going to do A, B, C. You know, God's going to use you to bring glory to his name, whatever. Something like that. God wants to use you in the ministry and things like that. Sure words that go forward. So, brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray about that. We're having the house blessing for the third orphanage. And, you know, I don't really care about these kind of a things. But, you know, like a social thing. But it's part of the ministry. You know, of course, the orphans are going to get to enjoy. We're going to have a lot of, you know, nice food. And I praise God, you know, that the ministry has the money to have a nice food. And the poor pastors to do the feedings. Not all of them, but lots of them who can come will be here on this coming Saturday. You know, we'll have nice food with them. I'm going to give them all, you know, a little bonus love offering to the pastors that come and stuff. And I ask you guys to pray about that. And, of course, you know, I know that God will provide, you know, to replace the budget that I use for these things because it's for the Lord and for his glory. You know, most of these pastors, brothers and sisters, don't even hardly have food to eat themselves. We do the feedings. They're also eating. They don't have a salary or anything like that, like in the States. And most of the parishioners have no money. So, you know, it's just God is, you know, providing for them as they go along. And there are some people who will say, yeah, that's the way we're supposed to be. Well, I assure you that you're probably not that way because you're on the internet. These people don't have the money for a computer. They don't have the money to, you know, or the time. They're so busy looking for something to eat and then doing the ministry, they don't have time to sit around a computer. You know, so like myself, my ministry from God is to be on here for Joshua's ministry and for the teachings that I do because I am a minister to the nations as the Lord has made me through YouTube. Praise God for that. Another sure word I got from the Lord. So praise God for that. So I asked you guys to pray for the third orphanage, and then I've got the fourth orphanage house parents, and the husband is not really saved. The wife is saved. The husband's not. I asked you to pray for them. That's orphanage number four that I'm going to make in a different area, and I'm thinking about and praying about go ahead and putting a couple of children with them. You know, I'm see how the husband will do, because the husband is, it's like I say, he's not born again, but he's open to it. You know what I mean? But I want to see how he'll react and see if he wants to be, you know, he's trying to do it because, you know, they want to have the orphans there because his wife wants to have the orphans. You know, they have only one child. They could only have one child, and their child is already grown, like 25 years old. So, and this woman is awesome. And the Lord already told me, hey, this woman, I want this woman for the ministry. But the husband, you know, so, I mean, the Lord already told me that the wife is for Joshua's ministry. So, you know, she's married, so. I know the Lord will deal with her husband, obviously. So I'm asking for prayers for him. His name is James. To pray for James, because he likes to drink too. I pray for him to get delivered from alcohol, for his salvation and all that. They'll be here Saturday, you know, and I'm going to be, because they're, you know, we're going to be talking about putting a few orphans with them. They live in another area 3 hours away in a different direction. And they already have a house. So if we put some orphans with them, you know, we don't have the expense of building a house and all that right now. We'd probably have to add a bedroom and another bathroom. We can do that later on. It's cheaper than buying the land and all that. So it's will save us finances and time. And short term, we could get it rolling. And so that's what I want to make. I'm going to need to make a decision about that on Saturday. Let's put it this way. I need to make a decision about that Saturday. So ask for your prayers and for final confirmation about that. And, of course, every orphan... Is it, you know, the minimum amount, you know, I always say the minimum amount, but it's more than that, $50 a month. That's not counting. They go to school, you know. In the Philippines, even public school, you have some tuition fees, you have to have uniforms, you know, transportation to school and all that. But the minimum is like $50 is their food per month, you know. And in the past, I had people, I still have some people that sponsor orphans directly, but 90% of my direct sponsors stopped sponsoring. And then several of them had tried to, have personal communication with their orphan, and then they stopped sponsoring, see? And I mentioned this in videos before. It's not good because these kids, most of them, they have at least one parent that's died, and another parent maybe, if they're alive, they run off. Like the dad, some of our orphans, like the dad is a fisherman with eight kids. And he stays gone out on the ocean for days at a time to catch fish. That's his living. And then he's a man, and then he's got a whole bunch of kids. His wife died. And so, their dad is not there for them. He had to give them up. He didn't have the money, or he didn't have the ability to take care of them. The mom died, and then get a sponsor, and then turn around, the sponsor quit. And so it's like causing trauma to these kids. And so that's why, I'm not going to allow too much of things like that. Now, if someone comes here and visits, that's a whole different thing, of course. Because, see, the kids are going to love someone who would visit here. And then, so, you can't turn around and do them wrong. I'm not going to allow it. And so, anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you guys to pray about that for the, our budget, of course. And I know, and I already know by faith, and I'm walking by faith through this whole thing, the Lord's going to provide. I'd ask you guys to pray in agreement with me. Because when the Bible says one puts 1,000 to flight, two puts 10,000 to flight. So, of course, if there's 100 of us praying, how much is that? I don't know. Multiply it out, millions and billion, whatever. So it makes it easier. I can, go through just by my own faith. But I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, the more people that are in agreement with you, the bigger and easier it is for mountains to be moved, because the Lord honors unity in His church. So I just want to say that too. All those who've already been praying and helping, those who have donated, those who pray, those who pray and donate, all the things you've done to help with the orphanages, the feeding programs, and all those things, God bless you and thank you so much. This is for the Lord, And, of course, even myself, too. I use my own money, too. So we're in it together in all things, brothers and sisters. As you guys know, a few people have told me, to keep mentioning it. I have, got a personal loan against my savings there in the States that I had wire transferred here to me to buy this house and everything for the third orphanage and a mission house. It's a third orphanage and a mission house, and a church. When I'm living here, when I come back here, while I'm here, I'll be starting a church here. Next time when I come back, I'll start a church there and then let the house parents, maintain it. And then when I'm here, I'll be the one to preach, because people will come. If they know there's a foreigner, a lot more people come just out of curiosity to hear some foreigner speak and speak in English and all that. It's interesting to people in a country like this. Most Filipinos, if they graduate high school, they can understand English pretty good. They might not be able to speak it fluently, but they can understand it. And I think that's normal with most people. Like myself, I can understand the local language, but when I try to speak it, my grammar's all messed up and my pronunciation. And I think that's all for everybody. In the whole world. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you guys to pray about that. I think we've received about, I gave the numbers. Before we built the orphanages, I never mentioned the numbers, because people might say, people wouldn't have the faith to believe. But this time I'm being more specific. We've gotten about $25,000 toward what we're spending, which is like $70,000. And then orphanage number four, like I say, I'm going to go. My tentative plan and final decision will be Saturday. Instead of buying the other land right now and starting on orphanage number four, maybe that'll be orphanage number five. But this time I can go ahead and put a few orphans with the house parents in their own house in another place, in a different city, in another area, 3 hours from here. It's a pretty good sized city, and there's lots of orphans in the area. Go ahead and start getting some, because there are some in that area. And then I can also test them, just like I'm testing and observing orphanage house parents number three. I can also test and observe orphanage house parents number four before we might build a room there when I come back in November, December time frame. By the grace of God, we can add a bedroom and another bathroom as needed and add more kids in orphanage number four. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray about all those things, that the finances would come in. And so, our monthly budget, we raised the amount of kids. We started out feeding 400 kids, whatever it was, and we went to 600, then 800, now 1,000 street kids. And in the orphanage, we keep adding new orphanages and orphans, everything of that. We have expenses. A house has, we have the electricity, the water, all that. Whatever, transportation to school for the kids, their food and all that stuff. I mean, you know, the budget is just, you know, it's just, it's ever increasing. As much as we have, that's what we'll do. You know, if the Lord gave me $1 million, I would make as many, whatever, as many orphanages and feedings we could do with $1 million. So whatever, that would be. You know, so our activities are in concert with our budget. So praise God for that. The Lord has been ever increasing, and I ask you guys to pray for that. That it will ever increase, and I believe and know that it will ever increase. As much as we can do, the Lord will provide. Now, that's what I tell those pastors. You know, when we first started, those pastors didn't have the faith. We're doing the feedings and all that. And I said, look, whatever vision we have, whatever prayer we pray, whatever vision we have, God will provide. And that's what the Lord told me about Joshua's ministry. He's reminding me again of that commission he gave me. He will provide. And I know he will. I'm just asking for you guys to pray in agreement with me. And just expedite it, you know, to speed up it and do more, more, more. You know, I want to do all we can. You know, and there's lots of people, the majority of people that watch my videos, they're just looking for when's the rapture going to be. And I want to tell you this again. I want to repeat this to you again. You know, that's probably one reason why, you know, my subscriber level is not the level of some people. It's because I'm straight up honest and bold, and I don't really care about stomping on people's toes. And a lot of people want to be babied and coddled and have their ears tickled. And, you know, brothers and sisters, that's not me. You know, that's not what the Lord wants anybody to do. I say all those that are doing that, they're out of the will of God in their style of teaching and preaching. So, because the Lord told us, you know, is saying that that's not right. In 1 Timothy, we see that it's not what the Lord wants. It's not proper preaching to, but we're supposed to exhort and rebuke and all those things. Be instant in season and out of season. My microphone's getting twisted up. I guess you had to turn up your volume if you couldn't hear it, but I want to tell you this. When we get to heaven, there's eternal consequences. Not just Joshua's ministry, but you guys are watching me. Of course, that's the elephant in the room and the subject at hand. So whatever, you know, people do for the Lord, we have treasures in heaven for that. That's why Jesus said, store up your treasures in heaven, not on earth. So tons of people, well, they say, you know, the survey says like 10% of people tithe, or 2%. I take that back. 2% of Christians tithe. You know, there's lots of Christians that try to justify themselves. I was talking to my wife about this last night because I was talking about the prosperity gospel, Joel Osteen and all these guys. You know what? The prosperity, out of balance gospel is wrong. I want to say that the prosperity gospel is not right. You know, it's out of balance. Let's put it that way. A lot of those prosperity people are out of balance with God's blessings on us. But what I was telling my wife last night, the majority of people who are supposed to be Christians that I talk to that are in the world, they use, you know, this bashing of prosperity gospel as a justification of why they don't ever give anything to anybody. Now, God is not dumb. God knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. He knows everything. Very few people are saying I'm against prosperity gospel because they want to live a pious life for Christ. The majority of people are convicted because they don't give anything, and they're convicted by the Holy Spirit that they're supposed to give. Jesus said, Luke chapter 7, give, and it will be given unto you. In good measure, pressed down and running over, will men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you give, it'll be measured back to you. And he who sows sparingly reaps sparingly. And so, brothers and sisters, in the New Testament, as it says, God loves a cheerful giver. No, it's not about the Old Testament law of tithing. The Lord took every one of those commandments to a whole new level. And I need to do a video about that. I've done videos about that until I'm about ready to get sick to my stomach because of the Judaizers, those who love to keep saying the Torah, the law, instead of saying the proper name that we use as Christians, the Old Covenant, the Old Testament. Even as Hebrews, the Bible book Hebrews calls it the Old Testament. And something that's old is waxing old and fading away, the book of Hebrews tells us, about the law, about the Old Testament. Go read it. So Jesus took all those commandments to a higher level. You know, as he said, oh, you've heard, it's been said, do not commit adultery. But I say to you, if you look on a woman with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. You've heard it's been said, thou shalt not commit murder. But I say unto you, when you look on your, when you're angry with your brother without a cause, you've committed murder in your heart. So about giving, the Lord is saying that he loves a cheerful giver in the New Testament. So not only should we give, but the Lord doesn't want you to give like grudgingly. So in the Old Testament, they were like, yeah, let me get my ticket punched to follow the law. Okay, on Saturday, I'm going to chill out, you know, and not gather any manna. And then I'm going to give 10% when I got to the temple. Check, 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 check. But in the New Testament, the Lord says that you would have a good heart about what you're doing. The Lord looks at the thoughts and intents of what's inside your heart, not your outward appearance. Religion is outward appearance, as Jesus said. You know, he told those Pharisees, you know, you're like a whitewashed wall. You're like those sepulchers, those white stone coffin, you know, and sarcophaguses. Sarcophagi. You look like one of those. The outside is white and clean, but the inside is full of dead man's bones, Jesus said. That's why Jesus said, when you have a cup, first clean the inside of the cup, then the outside will be clean also. You know, that's a message for people who are not truly born again, and for the Israelites. And I'm getting into a message of the gospel. But brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to tell this, what I'm trying to say to people, and I'm sure if they're running to and fro looking for the rapture date, they're probably not still watching this video after 31 minutes. So I'm preaching to the choir. God bless you guys who watch my videos. I appreciate it, all of you. What we do has eternal consequences. Our rewards in heaven, you know. And so, like I've told people that donated to Joshua's ministry, and then when I chat with some people and I'll say, well, you know, they'll say something like, well, brother, you know, Pastor Patrick, you're doing a great job there for the Lord. Well, we're a team. Those who have prayed, you know, we can't see those people who prayed for Joshua's ministry. God sees them. We can't see who's given to, you know, I saw the thing where somebody donated to PayPal or they sent Western Union or whatever they did. Well, no, I saw it, and I prayed for them, but, you know, the Lord saw it. That's what counts. And he's going to reward them. We're all together in a team. When we get to heaven, and the orphans are there, and those kids from the feeding program and their families, and you know, we got 1,000 kids, so I don't know what that would be. Lots of parents and relatives, whole families, and that doctor is going to give his testimony. I'm going to post that video of him Saturday or Sunday, of him telling about what all's going on there by the grace of God. He said he would do it. You know, how excited he is about all the fruit of the feedings there. He's an eye doctor. Dr. Kolauman is his name. But anyway, so when we get to heaven, it's going to be like we're there, and the Lord's going to be rewarding me for my part, and he's going to reward those who prayed and those who gave and all that. And we're going to be like, this is the people blessed because of what happened. You know, God wants to give a reward to all these people that were part of Joshua's ministry. That's all of us. I'm just a team player like you guys. You know, and I'm doing my part. But I can't do none of it without, you know, the Lord, you know, compelling the body of Christ to help me. I can't do it. You know, I'd already used my own savings before, and that's another thing which I mentioned back at that time. You know, my savings is getting to the point where, you know, I just had enough savings to live off of for how many years, I don't know. What happens in the stock market and all those things, how many more years I can continue to be self-supported in doing the ministry, I have no idea. But as far as the orphanages and all that, no, I couldn't financially do that. And, let you know, of course, the Lord can make money fall out of the sky and all that. He can do whatever he wants to do. He can make gold bars appear, whatever. I mean, I know the Lord will provide it, however way. But he likes to use his people, brothers and sisters. He likes to use us. You know, he likes to use us. So I praise God for that. And I thank you guys for listening to this video. I ask you guys to pray. And I've got all these hardcore videos to make for Israel. And my list of people are asking for a word is way, way long.